From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice. Here's your host.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA podcast. I am Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA and Professor of Medicine at Northwestern University. I'm here today with Dr. Mazyar Shadman, who is an Associate Professor at the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Center at the University of Washington. And today we'll be discussing Dr. Shadman's narrative review on the diagnosis and treatment of chronic lymphocytic leukemia. Welcome, Dr. Shadman.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
Let's start with having you tell us what is chronic lymphocytic leukemia and when should it be suspected as a possible diagnosis?
Chronic lymphocytic leukemia, or CLL, is cancer of mature B cells, and it presents in two forms. The form of leukemia, the CLL terminology is used for that, and there's another presentation that involves peripheral lymph nodes, and we call it SLL, or a small lymphocytic lymphoma. These two conditions are identical. And the most common presentation is CLL, and we usually think about it when we have a patient with lymphocytosis that is not explained by some of the common reasons for lymphocytosis, including infections and some of the autoimmune conditions or medications. So when there's a suspicion for a malignant lymphocytosis, that's the time that we think about making a diagnosis about a clonal lymphocytosis or cancer.
Are there risk factors for chronic lymphocytic leukemia?
There's no strong evidence to indicate that there is any environmental or occupational risk factor for CLL. It's a disease that seems to be more of a genetic disease than environmental. There are studies, for example, migration studies looking at patients who migrated from Japan to the US, and generations later, the incidence of CLL did not change. So it is believed that it's more of a genetic predisposition than a disease that has environmental risk factors.
How is the diagnosis made, and is a bone marrow biopsy needed?
So the diagnosis is made by using a test on peripheral blood, which is called flow cytometry. And this test looks at some of the signatures on the cancer cells. The pattern will tell us if this condition is consistent with CLL. And the answer to the bone marrow biopsy is no. Basically, at the time of diagnosis, most of the patients, all they need is that peripheral blood flow cytometry. We commonly see patients who are referred to us after the diagnosis and they have undergone the tests like bone marrow biopsy or even CT scan or sometimes PET scan. And most of the time, those are not necessary. In patients who are newly diagnosed with CLL and they don't have symptoms, and all we need is that blood flow cytometry, and we establish care and we follow the patients. And at some point, we may require those tests, but at the time of diagnosis, most of the time, those are not necessary.
Your review talks about the fact that many people presenting with CLL are asymptomatic. I wondered if you could speak to how common asymptomatic CLL is and whether they need to see a hematologist.
Yeah, that is, in fact, the most common presentation for our CLL patients. A typical patient would be someone who is having their yearly physical exam with their primary care physician, or before having a surgery, for example, they have a blood test and they're noted to have lymphocytosis, and that prompts workup and they're diagnosed with CLL. We do want to see patients with a newly diagnosed CLL. It's a condition, it's a blood cancer that requires a lifelong relationship with a hematologist or a medical oncologist. What we do, we start the conversation and educate the patient about the disease, but many of those patients go years without needing treatment. So we work very closely with our colleagues who are primary care physicians in following those patients.
And your review also talks about the higher rate of infections in patients with CLL. And I wondered if you could just summarize what the generalists should be paying attention to with regard to preventing infection.
CLL patients are known to have a higher risk for infection for many reasons. The disease itself is known to induce an immunocompromised state. And also patients who receive treatment for this condition, because of the nature of the treatments we use, are also immunocompromised. So prevention at different levels is necessary. For example, primary prevention, making sure that patients do consider themselves as being high risk, for example, during the pandemic, the CDC considers CLL, regardless of receiving treatment or not, as a group that required to be very careful and follow all the guidelines in terms of primary prevention. We do want our patients to be vaccinated against early influenza. Patients need to be vaccinated against pneumonia and also shingles. We also have some secondary prevention strategies for patients who have a history of infections, mainly sinus or lung infections, pneumonias, and these patients have a low level of immunoglobulin. We sometimes offer immunoglobulin infusion with an interval of every 6 to 8 weeks, for example, to make sure that the risk of infection is lower in these patients. Paying attention to early signs of infection, or patients, for example, who are taking different classes of drugs, as we reviewed in the paper, there are specific infections that should be considered even more specifically in those patient populations.
Do people with CLL who are asymptomatic need to be treated? And if not, then when should a patient with CLL be treated?
At the moment, there's no data to suggest that treating patients at the time of diagnosis and before they develop symptoms would provide a meaningful clinical benefit, or in other words, overall survival. So we're not helping patients live longer by starting treatment at the time of diagnosis. And that has been shown when we had chemoimmunotherapy regimens as a standard of care. Our treatment landscape has changed from chemotherapy to novel therapeutic or targeted drugs, and there are currently ongoing clinical trials that try to answer the question. But at the moment, we don't treat patients until they have a reason for treatment. And the reasons include having low blood counts. It could be presented as anemia. It could be having low neutrophil count or having thrombocytopenia or low platelet count. And if we do the investigation and decide or conclude that CLL is the culprit for those cytopenias, then patients do need treatment. Another reason to offer treatment is having large or symptomatic lymph nodes or a spleen or liver. And some patients may not have cytopenias or large lymph nodes or spleen or liver, but they may have general symptoms, including fever, lack of energy or fatigue, or weight loss that's unintentional. In other words, if disease causes any symptom that changes patients' quality of life, then we do need to intervene and start treatment.
What are the first-line therapies when you start treatment?
In 2023, we're now almost completely moved from chemotherapy to using targeted drugs, and that has been a paradigm shift in the way we treat CLL. So right now, we use drugs that either target an enzyme called Bruton tyrosine kinase, and these are oral drugs that patients continuously take the medication, and it would be like treating a chronic disease, and the treatment duration is indefinite. Patients take the drug until it doesn't work or if they have an adverse event that requires stopping the drug. So that's one option, and there are a number of examples from this family. Drugs like ibrutinib, acalabrutinib, or zanubrutinib are currently approved for CLL. The other example would be using a drug called venetoclax, and the way this drug works, it induces cell death in cancer cells, and we usually combine that drug, venetoclax, with monoclonal antibodies that target an antigen on the surface of cancer cells, and the drugs are obinutuzumab or rituximab, and in the first line, we use obinutuzumab. This treatment is a time-limited or fixed-duration therapy, meaning that patients take the combination for 1 year, and then they will stop treatment. There's no current clinical trial to tell us which strategy is better in terms of the overall efficacy, but both strategies are extremely effective, and most of the patients respond to the treatment, and they have very long remissions from each approach.
And when you say a very long remission, is that like 10 years or what on average?
Yeah, so these drugs, they've not been around for 10 years, the long-term follow-up. It's very close to 10 years now, and more than 80% of patients, for example, remain in some of the early studies. We know that up to 80% of patients still remain on the drugs now. Like any other treatment in cancer, it's not just about treating the cancer. Dealing with the side effects is also an issue. So some of the patients have to stop the treatment because of the side effects. But the good news is that we have now many new classes of anti-CLL drugs that we can use in later lines of therapy. So even if one treatment line fails the patient, we still have other options to offer.
And what are the common side effects?
Depends on the drug that we're using. The class that I first mentioned, the BTK or Bruton tyrosine kinase inhibitors, and I should mention that the first drug in this class is ibrutinib, and now we have second generation drugs, zanubrutinib and acalabrutinib, that come with much lower rate of adverse events. But in general, we think about some cardiac adverse events, including atrial fibrillation. There is a slight increased bleeding risk in these drugs. They have, and again, less with the second generation drugs, but still, for example, one of the recommendations we have for patients or their primary care physicians is that when they have a procedure, for example, planned, we want those drugs to be held between 3 to 7 days before and after, depending on the procedure. So bleeding risk and some other general side effects, for example, risk infection with ibrutinib, especially we do have issues with skin rash and some of the more general side effects like bone pain and muscle pain. So these are type of side effects. Increased blood pressure or hypertension, it seems to be a class side effect that is something that especially our colleagues who are general primary care physicians deal with that more than us, and they follow these patients. And sometimes it's difficult to treat the blood pressure that's hypertension that's a result of a burden tyrosine kinase inhibitor. For venetoclax or the BCL2 inhibitor, the main risk or the main side effect is early before starting or at the time of starting treatment. We have to be very careful in monitoring the patients because there is a high risk of tumor lysis syndrome if the drug is started at a full dose and without close monitoring. We do have strategies to decrease that risk significantly by slowly going up on the dose over the course of a few weeks, and also strategies to debulk the disease, meaning that we use another medication first to at least temporarily bring the disease burden down and the risk of TLS will be lower. And once the patient starts the target dose of venetoclax, it's usually a well-tolerated drug. Of course, with cancer medications, there's always a risk of cytopenias. We should be monitoring the neutrophil count and some maybe GI toxicity, but in general, a well-tolerated medication.
Is CLL curable?
Unfortunately, it's not curable, but I want to make sure that we talk about the definition of cure. In oncology, we are fortunate that in some diseases, we are able to at some point discharge the patient from our clinic and tell him that you don't need to see a doctor who's specialized in cancer for this disease, and we discharge them. And that happens in some of the cancers. With CLL, we're not there yet. The disease is not curable, meaning that, as I mentioned, there should be a relationship between the patient and the hematologist because the disease, by definition, is not curable at the moment with the treatments that we have. But it is very treatable. We can put the patient's disease in a remission, and those remissions can last for a long time. I just mentioned that we're close to a 10-year follow-up from some of these novel drugs. And the field is moving towards combining some of these new drugs to really induce very deep and sustainable remission, meaning that we don't see any evidence of cancer at the lowest level that we can detect by the current technology. And we're really hoping by doing that and by studying these combinations in clinical trials, maybe at some point we can use the word cure for CLL as well.
Is there a role for stem cell transplant?
Allogeneic stem cell transplant is a procedure that we use another person, a donor's immune system. And we basically take advantage of an immune attack that the donor cells make to the patient's cancer cells. This procedure used to be one of the main treatments that we had for CLL, mainly in the era of chemoimmunotherapy. And in fact, this is the only treatment strategy that can sometimes cure CLL patients. The problem is the procedure itself comes at a very high cost or risk of toxicity that may unfortunately lead to mortality from the procedure itself in around 20% of patients. So obviously, this is not something that we want to offer unless we really feel that there's no other reasonable option. What has happened in the past 10 years as these new targeted drugs are available, we have fewer patients who actually need that procedure of allogeneic stem cell transplant. But absolutely, for patients who have tried the targeted drugs and we feel that their alternative options are limited, we still do discuss allogeneic transplant, and there are patients who undergo that procedure. And I should mention that in the meantime, the allogeneic transplant technology or science has really improved, and we are also hoping that the mortality rate from the procedure at the current day would be much lower than what we have historically. So the answer is yes, we use it less often than before, and it is the only potentially curative therapy for CLL.
What is Richter transformation and how common is it?
So Richter's transformation is referred to the situation that CLL, which is considered to be a low-grade or indolent B-cell malignancy, transforms to a more aggressive or high-grade lymphoma, either large B-cell lymphoma or Hodgkin lymphoma, the risk is there somewhere between 1% to 2% per year. So it's a cumulative risk. And it is one of those true unmet needs in the field of lymphoma or CLL because, unfortunately, our treatment options for patients who develop Richter's transformation is limited. We are heavily investigating novel drugs in that space, and that would be a condition, for example, going back to your previous question, that if you're able to help the patient to achieve a complete remission, meaning that we use a treatment strategy and at least temporarily the disease, the Richter's part of the disease goes away, then we take advantage of that and send the patient allogeneic stem cell transplant. And that has been at least so far the most promising strategy. I should also add that all the novel drugs that we're investigating are also being tested for patients with Richter's transformation, and hopefully we'll have better treatment strategies.
Thank you so much. This has been really informative. Are there any other comments you'd like to make before closing?
Well, thanks for the opportunity. I just wanted to finish by saying that there's so much that's going on in the field of CLL. And as I mentioned, we're hoping that by combining our really effective and novel targeted drugs, hopefully we can start using the word cure for patients, and also for patients who, for any reason, don't respond to these treatments or respond initially and eventually relapse, we have better classes of drugs. And hopefully we'll get there at some point.
This is Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA, and I've been speaking today with Dr. Mazyar Shadman, who's Associate Professor at the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Center and University of Washington. Thanks for listening. For more of our podcast, please visit us at jamanetworkaudio.com. You can subscribe and listen wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. The audio team, listed alphabetically here, also includes Mary Lynn Furkeluk, Audrey Foreman, Lisa Hardin, Daniel Morrow, Hannah Park, and Dr. Linda Brubaker, Senior Editor, Multimedia. Thanks for listening.